Hello viewers, I am Dr. Robiul. I work as a lecturer in pathology in a medical college hospital, and I am making this video for my students and also for you. Hope someone finds this helpful. Today's topic is on liver cirrhosis part 2. This video will contain brief discussion about the morphology, clinical features, diagnosis and management of liver cirrhosis. Okay, so let's begin. So first we will talk about the morphology of liver cirrhosis. And always remember, whenever we are talking about the morphology of liver cirrhosis, the first thing that you have to remember is that in liver cirrhosis, the normal lobular architecture of the liver is lost. And what will we see here instead? Instead, we will see that there will be diffuse transformation of the entire liver into regenerative parenchymal nodules that are surrounded by bands of fibrosis. Let me explain. Recall from the previous video of this series, we had seen that a normal liver is divided into numerous lobules, and we had also talked about the structure of each hepatic lobule in the previous video. To summarize, always remember, each hepatic lobule is oriented around a central vein. So in the whiteboard, you can see on the far left of the board, I have drawn a normal hepatic lobule. You can see that it is oriented around a central vein. So this is the central vein. And we can also see that each hepatic lobule will contain portal tracts at its periphery. So here is one portal tract, here is another one, and here is another portal tract. And what were these inside the hepatic lobule? These were hepatocytes. They were arranged in sheets or plates that were extending from the portal tract towards the central vein. So that was the normal lobular architecture of a liver. And in liver cirrhosis, this lobular architecture will be lost. And instead, we will see something like this. So this image is a very simple diagrammatic representation of liver cirrhosis. We can see that there are some regenerative nodules drawn in the whiteboard. And surrounding those regenerative parenchymal nodules, we can also see bands of fibrosis that I have drawn in blue color. Now, always remember, why are we seeing this regenerative nodule? That is due to replication of surviving hepatocyte. Let me explain. Now, always remember, liver cirrhosis is occurring due to persistent liver injury. So there is liver injury, and that is happening for a long time, and that is causing death of hepatocytes. But at the same time, there are also hepatocytes that are surviving this injury. And the thing is, those surviving hepatocytes have remarkable ability to replicate. And they are replicating, they are multiplying, and they are responsible for these regenerative parenchymal nodules. And who was responsible for the fibrosis? We have also talked about that in details in the previous video. But to summarize, the hepatic stellate cell that was located in this space of DC is in fact responsible for the fibrosis. And the thing is, following persistent liver injury, the hepatic stellate cell becomes activated, and then it gets transformed into myofibroblasts. And like the name implies, myo, that means it has some contractile property, and fibroblast, that means it is fibrogenic. So hepatic stellate cell becomes converted into myofibroblast, and that was responsible for fibrosis. Now, the next thing that you have to remember is that in liver cirrhosis, we can have three types of nodules according to morphology. It can be micronodular, macronodular, and mixed type. Now, what is micronodular cirrhosis? We will say that liver cirrhosis is micronodular when the nodules are less than 3 millimeters in diameter. And usually the fibrous septa surrounding these micronodules will be thin. However, if there is collapse in some areas of the liver adjacent to these septa, that may also widen the septa. So usually those septas will be thin in case of micronodular cirrhosis. However, if there is collapse nearby, collapse of hepatic parenchyma nearby, that may broaden the fibrous septa. And in its active state, when there is active cirrhosis, these fibrous septa will also contain mononuclear leukocytes. Moving on to macronodular cirrhosis, we will say that liver cirrhosis is morphologically macronodular when the nodules are larger than 3 millimeters. And here the fibrous septa will be also broader. And regarding the mixed variety, we will say that the liver cirrhosis morphologically is of mixed type when there is presence of both micro and macro nodules in the liver. Okay, so that was in short about the morphology of liver cirrhosis. So now that we have talked about the morphology of liver cirrhosis, now we will move on and talk about the clinical features of liver cirrhosis. Now, patients of liver cirrhosis may show no symptom for a long period of time. In 40% cases of liver cirrhosis, the patients are asymptomatic until the advanced stage of the disease. Even when symptomatic, the symptoms may appear gradually. Sudden or abrupt onset of symptoms may also occur, but that is less common. The symptoms are usually non-specific. Among the non-specific symptoms, fatigue, weight loss, muscle cramp, disturbed sleep, these are the common non-specific symptoms. In advanced stage of the disease, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, diminished muscle strength, and reduced exercise capability may be also observed. Another interesting clinical feature in liver cirrhosis is abdominal pain. The thing is, in liver cirrhosis, initially the liver becomes enlarged, so there is hepatomegaly, and that enlarged liver may stretch the Gleason capsule that covers the liver, and that will lead to abdominal pain. Another cause of abdominal pain in liver cirrhosis is due to ascites. Now, what is ascites? It is accumulation of excess amount of fluid in the peritoneal cavity. Ascites may develop in liver cirrhosis as a complication. The thing is, in liver cirrhosis, as a complication of liver cirrhosis, the pressure in the portal circulation becomes elevated. That leads to portal hypertension, and ascites is one of the clinical manifestations that we will see in portal hypertension. We will talk more about portal hypertension shortly afterwards. Now, another clinical feature of liver cirrhosis is related to estrogen. The thing is, in liver cirrhosis, the metabolism of estrogen will become impaired. That will lead to elevation of estrogen level in the blood, that is called hyperestrogenemia, increased level of estrogen in the blood. And that will result in vasodilation in the palm, and that will result in palmar erythema. Now, what is palmar erythema? It is redness that will affect the thinner eminence, the hypothinner eminence, and the pulps of finger in the hand. Okay, and alcoholic liver cirrhosis is a very common cause of such palmar erythema. Now, whenever you mention this term, the examiner may ask you, what are the other causes of palmar erythema besides this alcoholic liver cirrhosis? The answer will be the other causes of palmar erythema besides liver cirrhosis will include rheumatoid arthritis, thyrotoxicosis, polycythemia, febrile illness, chronic leukemia, etc. And the examiner may also ask you, what is the mechanism of palmar erythema in liver cirrhosis or in alcoholic liver cirrhosis? And the answer will be high level of estrogen in the blood and also due to hyperdynamic circulation. Now, another skin manifestation that we may also see in liver cirrhosis is spider angioma. Now, what is that? It is central dilated pulsatile arteriole from which small vessels will radiate, and it will have the appearance of legs of spider. For example, suppose this is a central arteriole. I hope you can see this. And from this, small vessels are radiating like legs of spider. And this is known as spider angioma. Now, one or two spider angioma may be found in normal individual in 2% cases. However, when the number of spider angioma is more than two, it is often suspected that it is happening due to some pathological cause. Now, what are the other causes of spider angioma besides liver cirrhosis? The other causes will include viral hepatitis, estrogen therapy, or oral contraceptive pill that is containing estrogen. Rare causes will include thyrotoxicosis, rheumatoid arthritis, etc. Now, in a male patient, the elevated blood level of estrogen may lead to development of hypogonadism and gynecomastia. Now, what do we mean by gynecomastia? It is enlargement of the male breast. Similarly, in a female patient, the endocrine changes that are associated with liver cirrhosis may also lead to development of irregular menstruation, amenorrhea, breast atrophy, etc. Now, patients of liver cirrhosis may also suffer from glossitis and callosis. Now, what do we mean by glossitis? It is inflammation of the tongue. And what do we mean by callosis? It is painful inflammation of the corners of the mouth, and there will be also cracking in the corners of the mouth. And all these things are happening due to vitamin and nutritional deficiency that we see in a patient of liver cirrhosis. Now, jaundice is not an initial sign of liver cirrhosis. Mild jaundice may be seen in a patient of liver cirrhosis in the early stage of liver cirrhosis. And as the disease progresses, the severity of the jaundice will also increase. Jaundice may also lead to pruritus or itching. And sometimes the intensity of itching is so severe that the patient may scratch their skin raw. And what will happen next? The raw skin will result in repeated infection. So that will act as a source for repeated skin infection. Now, always remember, liver cirrhosis is the most common intrahepatic cause of portal hypertension. So here, portal hypertension will occur, it will develop due to increased resistance to portal blood flow in the hepatic sinusoids of a patient with liver cirrhosis. It can also happen due to increased portal blood flow as a result of hyperdynamic circulation. And in your textbook, you will see that there are four major clinical consequences of portal hypertension. So, what are those four major consequences? This is a very high yield question for your examination. And always remember, the major clinical consequences of portal hypertension will include ascites, development of portosystemic venous shunt, congestive splenomegaly, and hepatic encephalopathy. So the last one was hepatic encephalopathy. So now let's talk about those four clinical consequences one by one. And the first one was ascites. Now, what do we mean by ascites? I have already mentioned what do we mean by ascites. It is accumulation of excess amount of fluid in the peritoneal cavity. And always remember, at least 500 milliliter of fluid must be accumulated in the peritoneal cavity in order to detect ascites clinically. The ascitic fluid is usually serous in nature, and the protein content of the ascitic fluid will be less than 3 gram per deciliter. Now, for your exam, you also have to remember a very important term, and that is written as SAAG. This stands for serum to ascites albumin gradient. Now, what do we mean by this serum to ascites albumin gradient? It is the difference of albumin level in the serum with the albumin level in the ascitic fluid. And whenever we are examining a patient of liver cirrhosis who had developed ascites as a result of portal hypertension, this SAAG will be greater than 1.1 gram per deciliter. So always keep this thing for your examination. Always keep this thing in your mind for your examination, that here the serum to ascites albumin gradient will be larger than 1.1 gram per deciliter. Now, when we are examining the ascitic fluid, we will see that the ascitic fluid may also contain mesothelial cells and mononuclear leukocytes. If there is neutrophils present in the ascitic fluid, that may suggest presence of infection. And if we find blood in the ascitic fluid, that may also suggest presence of disseminated intra-abdominal cancer. So that was in short about ascitic fluid, and now we will move on and talk about the second clinical consequence that we see in a patient of liver cirrhosis when portal hypertension has also developed, and that was development of portosystemic venous shunt. Now, what do we mean by that? Now, hepatic portal vein and its tributaries direct blood from the gastrointestinal tract, spleen, and pancreas to the liver so that the ingested materials are first processed in the liver before they are reaching the systemic circulation. But in portal hypertension, as the pressure within the portal circulation is getting elevated, this flow is reversed. Venous bypasses will develop wherever systemic circulation and portal circulation are sharing common capillary beds. So now blood will flow through small and unimportant veins that are communicating between the portal circulation and systemic circulation. These veins will also become enlarged, and then they are also referred as varices. Now, the examiners are very fond of asking about the common sites of such varices. The examiner may ask you, what are the common sites of portosystemic shunt that we can see in portal hypertension? They are also called portocaval anastomosis. So always remember, the common sites will include the lower end of the esophagus, the lower end of rectum and anal canal, around the umbilicus, at the fissure of ligamentum venosum, etc. Now, what will happen in the lower end of esophagus during portal hypertension? We will see that during portal hypertension, the esophageal tributaries of left gastric vein will communicate with esophageal tributaries of hemiazygous vein. Recall from your anatomy classes that left gastric vein belongs to portal circulation, whereas the hemiazygous vein belongs to systemic circulation. So this is an example of portosystemic shunt that we can see in portal hypertension. Similarly, what will happen in the lower end of rectum and anal canal during portal hypertension? The superior rectal vein, which is a component of portal circulation, will communicate with middle and inferior rectal veins, which are components of systemic circulation. Now, what will happen around the umbilicus during portal hypertension? The para-umbilical veins, which are component of portal circulation, will communicate with veins of systemic circulation, for example, epigastric veins, lateral thoracic veins, intercostal veins, etc. And the abdominal collaterals will appear as dilated subcutaneous vessels that are extending from the umbilicus towards the rib margin, and they are also called caput medusa, that is Latin for head of medusa. They are called caput medusa because of their similarity in appearance with head of medusa, which contained venomous snakes instead of hair. Okay, so always keep this thing in your mind that they are called caput medusa, and medusa had snakes in the head instead of hair, and here the abdominal collaterals will also have similar appearance. Now, the third clinical manifestation of portal hypertension that we just mentioned a few moments ago was congestive splenomegaly. So now let's talk about that. Now, always remember, patients of liver cirrhosis may also develop long-term congestion in the spleen, and such congestion in the spleen will result in enlargement of the spleen, that is splenomegaly. Hypersplenism may also develop, and as a result of hypersplenism, we will also see thrombocytopenia, pancytopenia, etc. in a patient of liver cirrhosis. Now, the fourth clinical consequence of portal hypertension is hepatic encephalopathy. Now, hepatic encephalopathy is a spectrum of disturbance of consciousness. It can range from subtle behavioral abnormalities to severe state of confusion, coma, even death. Clinical features associated with such hepatic encephalopathy will include rigidity, hyperreflexia, and asterixis. Now, what is asterixis? It is also called flapping tremor. It is the non-rhythmic rapid extension flexion movement of head and hands that are seen in a patient of hepatic encephalopathy. To examine such case of flapping tremor, the patient is asked to hold his or her arms extended and wrists in dorsiflexed position. So it will be something like this. And sometimes the physician may push the hand, and sometimes the tremor may appear spontaneously. So whenever the patient is asked to do so, what will the tremor look like? It will look something like this. Okay, so the arm is held in extended position, the wrists are in dorsiflexed position, and then the patient of hepatic encephalopathy will show tremor, and the tremor is called flapping tremor due to its similarity with the wings of a flapping bird. Okay, so now that we have talked about the major clinical features of liver cirrhosis, now we will move on and talk about the diagnosis of liver cirrhosis. Now, in early or compensated cirrhosis, laboratory abnormalities may be absent. A frequent finding is anemia, and it is often macrocytic anemia. The causes of anemia in a patient of liver cirrhosis will include suppression of erythropoiesis by alcohol. This is seen in case of alcoholic liver cirrhosis. Other causes of anemia in a patient of liver cirrhosis will include folate deficiency, hypersplenism, hemolysis, bleeding from gastrointestinal tract, etc. So what will be the white blood cell count in a patient of cirrhosis? It may be reduced or elevated. White blood cell count will be reduced due to hypersplenism, and if there is infection, the white blood cell count will be elevated. Moving on to platelet count, always remember, thrombocytopenia is the most common cytopenia that is observed in a patient of liver cirrhosis. So what are the causes of thrombocytopenia in a patient of liver cirrhosis? It will include suppression of bone marrow by alcohol, splenic sequestration, folate deficiency, sepsis. So these are the causes of thrombocytopenia in a patient of liver cirrhosis. Moving on to prothrombin time, always remember, prothrombin time will be elevated in a patient of liver cirrhosis, and it is elevated due to reduced synthesis of the clotting factor. There will be elevation of aspartate aminotransferase and alkaline phosphatase, and they will indicate hepatocyte dysfunction and injury. Serum albumin level will be decreased gradually, and serum bilirubin level will be increased gradually. And in 91% cases, vitamin deficiency may be also seen in a patient of liver cirrhosis. Regarding imaging tests, ultrasonography is helpful in assessing the size of the liver and also in detecting hepatic nodules and ascites. Contrast-enhanced CT and MRI may be used to further investigate the hepatic nodules. Liver biopsy may also be performed, and it is performed by laparoscopy or by transjugular approach, and the findings of liver biopsy will include presence of regenerative parenchymal nodules surrounded by bands of fibrosis that we have discussed when we were talking about the morphology of liver cirrhosis. So now that we have talked about the diagnosis of liver cirrhosis, now we will move on and talk about the management of liver cirrhosis. Now always remember, although there is no cure for liver cirrhosis, treatments that can delay the progress of liver cirrhosis and treatments that can prevent further liver damage are available. So treatments will include lifestyle modification, general measures, treatment of complications, regular follow-ups, and in many cases, surgical interventions. Regarding lifestyle modification, if the patient of liver cirrhosis was alcoholic, the patient must stop drinking alcohol. Regarding general measures, the patient should have a palatable diet that should contain sufficient amount of calorie and protein. For example, in a case of compensated liver cirrhosis, the daily calorie requirement is between 25 to 35 kilocalories per kg body weight per day, and the daily protein requirement is between 1 to 1.5 gram per kg body weight per day. Whereas, if the patient of liver cirrhosis is also malnourished, the daily calorie requirement will be between 35 to 45 kilocalories per kg body weight per day, and the daily protein requirement will be 1.5 gram per kg body weight per day. Vitamin supplementations are also helpful in treating liver cirrhosis, and the patient will be also advised to get immunized. So the patient should get hepatitis A vaccine, hepatitis B vaccine, pneumococcal vaccine, as well as yearly influenza vaccines. So these were the lifestyle modifications and general measures. Moving on to treatment of complications, you can see that I have drawn three broad headings in the whiteboard. So they are the management of ascites, management of variceal bleeding, and management of encephalopathy. So let's talk about these things one by one. So first we will talk about management of ascites in a patient of liver cirrhosis. So salt restriction is very important. Salt restriction is done by limiting daily salt intake to 2000 milligram per day. Now, bed rest is also advised, and salt restriction along with bed rest is sufficient in some cases to reduce the ascites promptly. But in those cases where ascites is not reduced with salt restriction and bed rest alone, we have to give diuretic drugs. Spironolactone is a commonly used diuretic drug for this condition. The initial dose is 100 milligram orally daily, and the dose can be increased by 100 milligram every 3 to 5 days. The maximum daily oral dose, the maximum daily conventional oral dose of spironolactone is 400 milligram per day. However, in some cases, higher doses are also used. Now, in many patients, the side effects of spironolactone, for example, the painful gynecomastia that is associated with spironolactone is very intolerable. In those patients who cannot tolerate the side effects of spironolactone, another potassium-sparing drug is used, another potassium-sparing diuretic is advised, and that is amiloride. And the initial oral dose for that drug is 5 to 10 milligram per day. Now, often the action of spironolactone is augmented by using an additional diuretic, and if I want to be more specific, by using an additional loop diuretic that is called furosemide. And the dose of furosemide can be from 40 milligram per day to up to 160 milligram per day. Now, in many cases, there will be massive ascites in a patient of liver cirrhosis, and in many cases, the patient of liver cirrhosis may not respond well into the diuretic therapy as well. And in many cases, the patient may be intolerable to the side effects of diuretics. In those cases, large volume paracentesis is the treatment option. And here, large volume of ascitic fluid is removed from the peritoneal cavity with the help of a thin, long needle. So that is large volume paracentesis, and that is done in case of severe ascites and also in cases of refractory ascites, the ascites that is not responding to diuretic therapies. And what is this TIPS or TIPS? It means transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunt. This is also sometimes used in treating refractory ascites. Moving on to management of variceal bleeding, the treatment options will include use of beta blockers, use of vasoconstrictor medicines, and TIPS can be also used. As a matter of fact, TIPS is mainly used here in management of variceal bleeding. So again, TIPS stands for transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunt. Here a shunt is made and that bypasses blood and results in reduction of the portal hypertension. Other measures that can be taken to reduce variceal bleeding will use endoscopic variceal banding or sclerotherapy. The next treatment of complication is regarding management of hepatic encephalopathy. And you can see that first thing written in the whiteboard is protein restriction. The second one is lactulose. Now, what is lactulose? Lactulose is a synthetic, non-absorbable disaccharide syrup. It is given to the patient and it will go to the colon, and there the colonic bacteria will convert lactulose into short chain fatty acid. So that will make the colonic content acidic, and that will result in conversion of ammonia into ammonium ion. So first it was ammonia and now it is ammonium ion, NH4+. Okay, and ammonia or NH3 was neurotoxic and absorbable, whereas ammonium ion, that is NH4+, is not absorbable. And that's how, by using lactulose, we can reduce the effect, the harmful effect of ammonia on the brain and reduce hepatic encephalopathy. Other measures that we can take in managing hepatic encephalopathy will use avoiding sedatives, narcotics, and anti-anxiety medicines. Now, we are almost at the end of today's video. The last bullet point on the whiteboard regarding management of liver cirrhosis is liver transplant. Now, always remember, in some cases, the patient of liver cirrhosis will not respond to medical therapy. And in those unresponsive yet life-threatening cases of liver cirrhosis, liver transplant is the only option. Okay? And in those cases, liver transplantation is advised. So this concludes today's video on liver cirrhosis part 2. I hope this video was helpful. If you like my videos, do comment, share, subscribe, and let me know. And for my students, I will also recommend you to go through your textbooks to know more information. Okay, so that's all for today. Until next time, take care and stay blessed. Thank you. Thank you.